Hey friends, James Irish here. We're going to forgo the usual opening gag because we got two things to take care of. One, a correction. Turns out Mel Blanc was not allergic to carrots, he just couldn't stand them. But as we said, they did try every other vegetable and nothing sounded like a carrot but a carrot.
Wah-wah.
So they just record those last. And secondly, it being Pride Month, sexuality and gender identity are messy. They're complicated. They're not the binary that a lot of us grew up believing them to be. So when figuring that stuff out, people do probably need a place to reach out to help. And for that, there's the Trevor Project. We invite you to go to give.thetrevorproject.org to make a donation, especially this month, because they are matching your donations up to a certain point. But every month, because as Chrissy said to me before we started recording, don't just be an ally, be an accomplice.
Because you know what? You can be an ally, but it's much more fun to help. So this month, to everyone out there, help out, because we're all in this together and we should be helping each other out. So to all of our friends in the Alphabet Mafia, the Rainbow Brigade, and even those of us who aren't in that, we're in this together. So for this month, my challenge to all of our listeners, do not be an ally, be an accomplice.
Not if you insist, Chrissy.
What's that?
I said if you insist.
I will cover for all of you. I will be your alibi, and I will teach you how to cover up the body. I taught forensics, Roses.
I just blamed someone else for my cover-ups.
Blood stains are red, luminol glows blue. I taught forensics long enough, they will never find you.
In a fictitious studio, they are a certain comic trio. Watching tunes from the net, some more harder to get, and ones we'd rather forget. This is a Pamma, James, and Chrissy sort of kind of hopefully funny cartoon podcast.
Hello everyone, I'm James Irish.
I'm Chrissy Harding.
Welcome to the Pemmy, Chrissy, and James kind of sort of hopefully funny cartoon podcast, or the Pemmy, James, and Chrissy kind of sort of hopefully funny cartoon podcast, or the Pemmy and Friends podcast, or...
We're still workshopping it.
Whatever you want to call it, just don't call us late for dinner.
No, we're definitely never that.
But unfortunately this time and next time, our dear friend Pemmy is going to be in absentia. He's taking a much-needed sabbatical.
We have a cutout for him, though. He's right here.
Yeah.
It's amazing what I could do with pop-tops.
So, we have been calling into the bench to fill in. Not that we weren't going to have them on anyway, but their being here now is that much more important. So this week, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome friend of the podcast and longtime supporter of Artificial Orange Studios, Mio.
Woo!
Thanks for having me, gang.
Yay!
Glad to be here.
Before we get too deep in, do you have anything you want to plug?
Not really.
Okay.
Just wanted to double check.
Lots of people just want to give me money. I'll take that.
Give money to Mio. Mio's the one who absolutely enjoys every time I add a new plushie to my collection.
Well, that's fun.
Oh, yeah. I know. Oh, I got to post a picture. I got to post a picture of the Polter Pup. I'll do that when the Luigi Mansion 2 comes out. I'll post a picture of Polter Pup because I have a Polter Pup now. Yay!
So this week, we are checking over our course registration as we look at Tiny Toon Adventures.
The original, not the new one that's out on HBO Max, which I do actually recommend people watching because that is fun.
Yes, it's good. I agree. Yes.
And our story begins right around where another story that we alluded to in our last episode ends. The conclusion of principal filming of Who Framed Roger Rabbit, the insanely ambitious and even more insanely successful hybrid of live-action and animated movie featuring both compelling original characters in a great mystery story and a cameoing cast comprised of a who's who of classic theatrical cartoon characters from the period of the 1930s to the early 1940s.
But we will not mention the shoe scene because that's still too traumatic. It's still too soon.
Except you kind of already did.
No, but see, those who are young enough and never seen the film don't know what I'm talking about.
Okay, so we won't discuss it. We'll just mention.
Exactly. Exactly.
Produced by Steven Spielberg's Amblin Entertainment for Disney's Touchstone Pictures, you could see the affection he and the team making the movie had for these characters in nearly every frame of animation. In fact, some characters the team were so fond of, they included them as cameos despite their not being introduced until the late 1940s, namely Wile E. Coyote, The Roadrunner, and Marvin the Martian.
Yeah, they were fun to see.
Yep, very much so. And again, all of Roger Rabbit's fun.
Hey, you know, if we ever do Roger Rabbit, we'll have you back for that.
Okay.
And the nice thing with Roger Rabbit was it brought back that hybrid of live action and animation. And it really wasn't the first movie to do so, though. There was the one with Gene Kelly and Tom and Jerry Mouse, actually.
At least we forget Mary Poppins and Bedknobs and Broomsticks.
Much against the original author's wanting of that, because she really didn't want any animation in the Mary Poppins movie, but it's Disney, so you know it's going to happen.
I love Bedknobs and Broomsticks.
Oh, I love Bedknobs. That was my favorite growing up. I love that whole thing.
Now, around this time, the president of Warner Brothers, Terry Semel, wanted to re-enliven their animation division and thought taking cues from the popular trend of kiddifying existing franchises was the right place to start. Of course, the most famous version of this would be Jim Henson's Muppet Babies, a show sadly lost to time due to the many copyrights involved.
Yeah, but it was fun when that was on.
And Hanna-Barbera was really going to town with this concept with the likes of the Flintstone Kids and a pup named Scooby-Doo.
I love a pup named Scooby-Doo. That was one of my favorites watching. I always made sure to watch that when it was on.
Since Spielberg and Amblin had successfully reached out to Warner to bring in the Looney Tunes characters for the Roger Rabbit movie and were more than reasonable working within their demands on how their characters would be portrayed and how long each character would be portrayed in comparison to their Disney counterparts, Amblin was Semmel's choice to produce the series. Semmel and Spielberg, alongside Warner Brothers head of licensing Don Romanelli, eventually settled on making brand new characters who are reminiscent of, but not directly related to, the classic Looney Tunes characters.
I have to say that was actually probably a very smart choice of theirs to make them not related to them and not like a kid version of the original Looney Tunes. I do have to say that was a very smart move.
I have to agree.
I applaud that creative choice.
I just really liked Tiny Toons when I was growing up. It was just a fun show to always watch when I was needing something to watch at the time.
It was just fun. It was more fun to having brand new characters versus already established characters in the Looney Tunes universe.
Not that Bugs, Daffy, and the rest were going to be absent, mind you. More on that shortly. But the initial plan, given the success of Roger Rabbit, was to make the Tiny Toons into a theatrical feature. But eventually, at the end of 1988, a television series was decided to be the best way forward. Now, at that time, much like Disney, Warner was already dipping their toes into television animation, working with Ruby Spears and Nelvana to bring some of their film properties, Police Academy and Beetlejuice, respectively, to syndication. But this would be several magnitudes bigger than either of those projects.
I mean, Police Academy was kind of a miss. Beetlejuice, totally a hit. It was like 50-50.
Quickly, a team was assembled, with character creation being headed up by Tom Ruger, who would also act as the head writer. Tom had experience with this sort of thing, having been one of the lead creative forces behind the aforementioned Pup Named Scooby-Doo series.
Woo!
And influencing much of its self-referential humor.
I think it's one of the reasons why I love it. I love it when a series is smart enough on itself that it does break the fourth wall and does it effectively.
Now, his mentality fit right in with the tradition of the Looney Tunes deriving laughs from darn well anything they could get their hands on. From radio routines to the fact that Bing Crosby owned a racehorse that was terrible at racing.
I learned something new right now. I did not realize that Bing Crosby was horrible at picking racehorses. Somehow that doesn't surprise me either.
Now, we're not going to do an impression of Bing because otherwise his estate will sue us, much like they've sued our friends at That's Not Quite All, folks.
Well, you know, he wasn't exactly, rich at the end of his life, so they got to get any money any way they can.
And Tom Ruger wasn't alone, of course. Animation division head Gene McCurdy, who took the job in 1989 just in time to be a key influence on this show. Journeyman writer Wayne Katz, who had just wrapped up writing the 13-episode run of The Completely Mental Misadventures of Ed Grimley.
I missed that show.
And producer, writer, animator, all-around talent Sherry Stoner would also be major contributors to the creative process, along with Spielberg himself.
Considering what we've heard about Spielberg in other episodes, this could be both a good thing and a bad thing.
Could be.
Yeah. At least Jeffrey Scott is not a part of this project.
Thank you. Now we can have an excuse to use that lightning bolt again.
I was looking for a reason to justify us paying money for it. Can't believe you paid for that.
Collectively, this team cast a wide net, gathering more talent for the series, recruiting animation studios like Tokyo Media Shinsha, Wang Film Productions, and Kennedy Cartoons, and a rogues gallery of writers, including Bruce Timm, Paul Dini, and Arlene Sorkin.
Yay!
Yes, that's how they met, and set in motion the events that would lead to the creation of Harley Quinn for Batman the Animated Series.
Oh, Mr. J!
And the voices! Voice director Andrea Romano, a veteran working for shows ranging from the revival of the Jetsons for Hanna-Barbera to one of the 5 voice directors on Disney's DuckTales, auditioned something like 1,200 vocal talents to fill the shoes, or, well, bare feet, of these new and old characters.
Oh, yeah, because this was right after Mel Blanc passed away.
We'll break down individual voices all throughout this episode, but we should mention now that, yes, Mel Blanc was indeed planned to reprise his classic characters once again. But his passing in 1989 required their recasting, a process that gave us the first wave of new Looney Tunes performers that would produce brilliant performances over the years. The Looney fandom owes a massive debt to Bob Bergen, Jeff Bergman, Greg Burson, and the late Joe Alasky.
I wonder how excited Mel Blanc was to be able to come back and do these characters for a whole new audience. But we got a whole bunch of brand new stack of talents voicing these characters for a whole new generation of fans. So now release the Wile E. Coyote versus Acme movie. Warner, release it.
The eventual result came out in September of 1990, first as a pilot special on CBS, with the series as a whole airing in syndication, since CBS passed on a full series purchase. In picturesque Acme Acres, our cast of new characters attend Acme Luniversity to learn from the original Looney Tunes cast how to become the next generation of cartoon stars. The ostensible leads are Babs and Buster Bunny.
No relation.
Who are kind of what would happen if you split Bugs Bunny's personality and characteristics in half and fleshed each of them out. Buster is laid back, in control, and ready to retaliate when significantly wronged, while Babs is a silly and outgoing comedian with a penchant for vocal impressions. And a bit of a self-control issue.
I think she has ADHD.
Very likely.
Yeah.
Their closest friends are Plucky Duck, who takes very much after his idol Daffy to agree that he's sometimes been called a green-colored Xerox of him, and Hampton J. Pig, who inherited Porky Pig's straight man tendencies, but has his own distinct comedic quirks.
Yeah, he actually does. He's more of like the neurotic member of the group, to an extent.
Acting as the principal antagonists to not just the bunnies, but the region in general, are the heirs to the mantles of Yosemite Sam and Elmer Fudd. Montana Max, the rich brat with a temper that could topple mountains if he doesn't buy it outright.
Or he probably has.
And Elmira Duff, a cutesy talking pet aficionado whose idea of love and tenderness translates to severe injuries for her victims/pets.
I just noticed that her last name is Fudd, spelled backwards.
Yeah, I only realized that myself.
Well, as it turns out, we're not going to be talking about Buster a ton, or Max very much at all in this episode. And while Plucky does play a significant role in the proceedings we will be looking at, they're not speaking roles voiced by Alasky. That's kind of how our episode selection process wound up going. Pemmy didn't have a ton of experience with the series, and left it to Chrissy and I to select the viewing material. And she and I both have personal favorite characters in the series who are not any of the six we just discussed.
Although I did write a fan fiction at one point, it was a Harry Potter one, but we put Elmira in it to torture Voldemort when he got turned into a rabbit.
Oh, dear Lord. I feel so bad for you.
I need to see this now.
I'll send it to you. I think I have it somewhere on my computer. I'll send it to you. It was back when it was written in the 20s, and it features a much more younger version of Phoebos, Morphia, and Nex.
So in other words, characters you've used elsewhere for D&D campaigns.
Before they ended up in D&D campaigns as gods.
Yeah, just for context for people who are not privy to our every other Friday night.
I one day will end up writing a fantasy series with them in it, so people can actually read it if they want to. You can find it also on fanfic.net under the name Maisha Wolf.
Hopefully we haven't completely lost Mio at this point.
Only partly.
Sorry.
Babs, Hampton, and Elmira, though, all feature prominently in the shorts we did pick, which means we're halfway there at least. Also, why did we pick only shorts and not entire episodes? Well, since the stated goal of the series is to have these characters be the, quote, next generation, unquote, of Looney Tunes, why not see how their exploits hold up in the format Bugs and Company were most famous for?
Yeah, which is shorts. Don't worry, we'll do the long format next year.
I understand why we keep talking about pants in this way.
That's fair. That's very fair.
Yeah, episodes were split into two or three short subjects, or were full half-hour adventures, you know, including commercials. Yeah. So the format was flexible to what the story or stories of the day required. This gave the supporting cast their moments to shine. And it's from those moments that those secondary characters became as popular as the core cast, despite their comparatively reduced screen time. So, like we said, when we do revisit the series, which we hope to eventually do, maybe next year, maybe another year. You know, it's not written in stone yet.
Yeah.
Well, I'm not going to be so to write it down then.
Well, the list is extremely flexible at this point. Depends on how much we want to torture ourselves or if we need to have a fun break. Or when you're available.
Or if there's an anniversary coming up that's important.
Or if somebody dies.
Yeah, that's happened.
Yeah.
More twice now.
Yeah.
But when we do, we will zero in more on Buster, Plucky, and Max, and look at the longer format stories at the same time. So the first short we watched, Optical Intrusion, was written by Tom Minton and directed by Art Vitello. This illustrates our point about the supporting cast getting to shine by focusing in solely on Furball, the blue-tinged young counterpart to the ever-versatile Sylvester the Cat. Furball is one of Chrissy's favorites, so I cede the floor to her to tell us why.
Well, just how can you not love Furball? I mean, he's cute. His design is absolutely adorable, first off. He's actually he's one of the three non-speaking characters in the show. I mean, he does have like one or two lines every so often, but I love when you give a non-speaking character who has so much character to him and you express it in animation. He tries so hard just to either A, survive, or B, just find a home. And they actually did dedicate a whole episode to him trying to find a home, just finding a home, whether with Elmira or Mary Melody, you know, him just finding a home. And there's just times you just want to like pick up Furball and just take him home with you and just be like, honey, I'll take good care of you. You just stay here. Because he does try so hard. And like I said, his design's adorable. And I like him better than Sylvester, because where Sylvester sometimes can be mean, Furball's just trying to be a good kitty cat. I like good kitties.
So the Acme 3D Glasses Factory looks more exciting on the outside than in, if the two chums testing the product are any indication. And this is why I'm heartbroken Pemmy couldn't make it for this episode. Because one of these guys, the taller, younger one, is clearly Rob Paulsen. Since this voice sounds like a rough draft of the vocal inflection that would become Pinky of Pinky and the Brain fame on Animaniacs.
I gotta ask, I wanted to ask you this when I saw it. Is the older guy Maurice?
I was thinking,
is this like the beginning of Pinky and the Brain? Because that did sound like Maurice.
It did sound a lot like his voice for Brain, that's for sure. Yeah. I just wondered if it was Potts, because it looks so much like Potts from Animaniacs.
I know. The design was definitely Potts. Yeah, I definitely thought that too. I was like, oh, is this the beginning of like Potts? But like the voice sounded like one of the voices Maurice does before Brain. It wasn't Brain's voice, but it did sound like Maurice's voice. But it was definitely Rob Paulsen doing the tall guy.
Well, I'm on the Tiny Toons wiki right now, and while Maurice LaMarche is in the episode as Dizzy Devil, he's not credited as one of the 3D glasses testers.
Darn, that would have been awesome if he was.
Indeed. Would have been really funny.
So for the moment, maybe?
Okay, I'll take a maybe. That would have been great if he was and they eventually became Pinky in the Brain. That would have been hilarious.
Yeah, some mishap with the 3D glasses turned them into lab mice.
They're Pinky and the Brain. They're Pinky and the Brain.
So this tall one is still enthused by the optical illusions of 3D glasses, making images seem to jump off the paper. But his coworker is just done.
We all have coworkers like this. We either are that coworker or we've worked with somebody like this.
But then a poster jumps off the wall right at this other guy. And the next thing his coworker knows, he's pulled to the glasses too. The resulting pull apart sends them tumbling into some supplies where glue gets all over the gravitational glasses.
Rejected.
Yeah, either way, the product is deemed too effective. They're rejected and promptly tossed in the nearest trash can in the alley. This raises a minor question.
What's that?
This is accidentally a scientific breakthrough. Shouldn't they have saved this for R&D?
Okay, you're asking two guys who work on the front line who look through glasses all day to think beyond their pay grade.
Fair. Still,
I mean, yes, it is a scientific breakthrough, but not one they particularly care about.
Plus, you gotta wonder how many other times they've come across this, so to them this is like another one?
Possibly. I'm not trying to apply logic. It's just a little itty bitty question mark that popped up in my head.
Yeah, it's not just a wait just a moment. Yeah, it's not a wait just a moment.
Now, Furball is right next to this trash can looking for scraps of food and eventually comes across the eyewear. And the meows, screeches of pain, and occasional spoken words of this poor kitty are provided by podcast favorite Frank Welker.
We do love Frank.
He would also perform Go Go Dodo and another character we'll be looking at later on.
Freaking love Go Go Dodo too. He's another fun one. Yeah, for every JS that we mentioned, we do Frank Welker just balances that out.
Putting the glasses on, Furball gets down with his bad self with some Michael Jackson inspired moves, and then picks up a discarded metal tray to check his reflection. And so it begins.
Pain starts.
Yeah, I do have to say, I do enjoy the fact that they did do that, the Michael Jackson move, because back then, every kid who put on 3D glasses tried to act like Michael Jackson and do a moonwalking. So,
especially if they were just coming out of Captain EO.
Exactly. Like, that was very cool to go back to seeing that and being like, yep, I knew so many guys who used to pull that shit.
I was not one of them. I didn't ever really do that sort of thing.
Listen, I had guy friends who would try to do the moonwalk, and I'm like, you're not moonwalking. Just stop. Just stop.
I realized I couldn't do it and just never tried to do it again.
Yeah, you try it once and you people are laughing at you. You're like, I'm never doing this again. I'm
nobody really laughed. I just tried it and couldn't do it, so I just decided never to try it again.
That's fair. How about you, James?
There's too much gravity around me to properly moonwalk.
That's fair.
Recovering from that collision, Furball stumbles out of the alley, only to come face to face with a mailbox, which is just about to be emptied by a postal worker. And the adorable meow from Furball when this happens is so perfectly timed.
I know.
Once Furball gets rid of the mailbox and recovers his head, he struggles to remove the glasses to no avail, just winding up with his feet in his face.
Nobody really likes that.
Yeah.
He notices, though, a bird on an electrical wire singing blissfully, and Furball suddenly realizes he can use this mysterious force to his advantage when it's pulled into him. Now, how do I know it's an electrical wire and not a phone wire or anything like that? To crib some lines from the world of clickbait, the answer will shock you. It sure shocked him.
Well, you know, it just lit up his world.
It was just so electrifying.
I got nothing.
Yeah.
It's so hard to shock the audience at this point in our relationship.
Wandering into the Acme Bird Shop, Furball hopes for some luck to come his way, and he just gets a mouthful of bird cage.
Yeah, you know, you gotta get through the bars, dude.
Well, it could be worse. It could have been the movie bird cage he got in his mouth.
That's fair.
That could have been awkward.
That is very fair. Of course, was Birdcage? No, Birdcage wasn't out yet.
No,
the French version might have been.
Well, you know, La Cage du Follet was always a play, and that was out. You know, you are what you are.
Winding up next to an outdoor fish market, you'd think this would be pay dirt, except for the live lobsters that were just set out.
No, I just never understood why he looked at them in the first place. It's like you saw the fish, you were looking at the fish, then he brought the lobsters out. Why do you look at the lobsters? I'm like,
I think it was the motion drew his eyes to it, and it's like, no, keep your eye on the prize. You had it hook, line, and sinker.
Now these things really need to go, and Furball hooks them onto a fire hydrant. The first attempt just gets his head conked, but the second, he grabs onto a passing fire truck. The force of attraction of this evil eyewear is too great, sending Furball and the fire truck's ladder he was holding onto right back to the hydrant, unleashing the water, which gets pulled by the glasses and throws a waterlogged Furball into the city dump.
I need to know what this glue is made of, because, man, I could use this for some pranks at work.
Well, it's just glue. It just works differently on tunes. You gotta understand that.
Oh, so it's tune glue.
Well, yeah, I see it as it's just normal glue that normal people use, but to tunes, it's like a whole different substance that just sticks to you and you have a hard time getting rid of it.
Yeah, that's fair.
Whatever's funny.
Yep.
It's whatever it calls for, I guess. It's plot glue.
There we go.
Now, there's not much meaner than a junkyard dog if the late, great Jim Croce is to be believed, and one's growling right at Furball.
At this point, he's just kind of giving up.
Of course, Furball's pulled in by the glasses, leading to the cat being stuck in the doggy's mouth. Poor Furball is too pooped to resist constantly being forced into the dog's fang-filled face, until the dog gets wise and tries to stop it, only for a sink to come his way.
And then a bathtub.
And then a car.
And then an airplane.
And the Titanic.
And there's a bus in there somewhere, too.
Yeah. And a cruise ship, and because, you know, why not?
Coming out of the rubble, the glasses are finally off of Furball, who celebrates until he realizes they're on the dog. And the last thing we see are Furball's sad eyes as the poor kitty mews helplessly while the jaws close down on him.
Poor Furball. Indeed. He can never catch a break.
Chrissy, I'm sorry I didn't pick one that ends more happily for Furball, but I don't think there's that many.
There's none that really end happily for Furball. He's just a down-on-luck kitty.
Except for that one American Tail pastiche.
Oh, that was a good one. But that one, I think that one's a long-form episode. That's not a
short
one.
Yeah.
So, no, but this is a good one. This one actually shows a lot of his cute comedic timing. It shows a lot of his physical humor, which is good. It's good to see that. So, no, this is actually one of the better Furball episodes. So, even though it doesn't end happily for Furball, it's one of the funnier ones.
Heck, it's one of the better ones, period, for the series. The timing is just so on point.
Yeah.
So we move from Chrissy's favorite of the cast to my favorite of the cast, Calamity Coyote, who was also briefly voiced by Frank Welker the few times he made any sounds, and who was arguably a more successful super genius than his inspiration Wile E. Coyote ever was.
Mostly because Calamity just works with whoever is willing to listen to or pay attention to his scientific achievements.
While Calamity would be used as one of Montana Max's seconds in a couple early episodes, he settled into the supporting cast as a technically minded inventor who was easy to get along with and aided Buster and Babs frequently. He also had a very specifically dismal kind of luck. Technology of all sorts always seemed to backfire on him whenever he was trying to use it to his own benefit. And not just when the young roadrunner named Little Beeper was involved.
Yep.
I mean, when even a simple game show buzzer won't work for the guy, you know some force in the world is against him.
Well, his first name is Calamity. You are already off on the wrong foot. By the way, have you noticed that our two favorite characters are the two characters in the show that have the worst possible luck on their own? They're not even bad guys. They just have bad luck.
Says something about the two of us, doesn't it, Chrissy?
It does, doesn't it? No wonder we get along so well.
So this next short, Sensorly Yours, Babs, from the episode The Acme Acres Zone, is a typical example of how Calamity was utilized in the larger cast. It was written by Tom Minton and Sherry Stoner, and directed by Ken Boyer. But hey, this is ostensibly a feature cartoon for Babs. So we focus in on her in the Luniversity joke room, where Babs is improvising jokes based on Hampton's prompts. Babs is voiced by Tress MacNeille, who had used a similar voice for Gadget Hackenwrench on Disney's Chip 'n Dale Rescue Rangers. And she's also known for Dot in Animaniacs, Agnes Skinner on The Simpsons, and is the current voice of both Wilma Flintstone and Daisy Duck.
Mm-hmm.
Hampton, meanwhile, is someone this podcast knows very, very well by this point. The esteemed Don Messick.
Woohoo!
Best known for Scooby-Doo, Papa Smurf, and Boo Boo Bear. Narration from Buster Bunny, in keeping with this episode's overarching Twilight Zone pastiche, explains that Babs is always on the hunt for the perfect joke. Buster, real quickly, is Charles Adler, who would go on to do all the most prominent characters for Cartoon Network's Cow and Chicken and perform as Darwin in The Wild Thornberries. But we last heard him on this podcast, horribly miscast, as Roddy Piper in Hulk Hogan's Rockin' Wrestling.
And he went on to do a lot of other cartoons in the 80s, too. I think, wasn't he on Transformers as well?
I think so.
And he was on...
I mean, who wasn't on Transformers back then?
That's fair. That is very fair. I was going to say Leonard Nimoy, but I think he was on Transformers.
Well, for the movie.
Yeah. Count. It's part of Transformers. He counts.
So Hampton observes that Babs is the funniest rabbit he knows, and she expresses her desire to be the funniest rabbit anyone knows, and knows how to make it happen, literally shoving Hampton along to visit Calamity Coyote, super kid genius at work in the advanced science labs.
Poor Calamity. I think Calamity is like where everyone goes like, I need a machine to do this, and Calamity's like, I got you.
Babs has asked the brilliant kid to make a machine to further enhance her sense of humor. Just her asking him how it's going causes him to get shocked by the wires he's handling. But his sign says, all set, so the procedure can begin. You see, Calamity communicates strictly holding up signs. Just like Wile E. would in the Roadrunner cartoons. But not the ones where he's up against bugs.
Wile E. Coyote, super genius.
Now Hampton has his doubts. But Babs has faith in Calamity's safety precautions, even if he's wearing a hazmat suit to start the device.
Which I think is
a
great
thing. That's a bit of a concerning.
But at the same time, it's a great gag. It's like, I trust Calamity. Calamity's there in like a hazmat suit going, yeah! Like, I got questions, dude.
As Hampton is put in a similar suit, Babs feels her sense of humor rising to the top and out of her body.
So this is what an out-of-body experience feels like.
A disembodied, quasi-ghost-like, madly laughing second Babs emerges from her physical body, leaving Babs Prime, which is how we'll refer to Babs' actual body going forward, to sound deflated and stilted.
Yeah. You gotta give Tress McNeil really good, because like she does a good job differentiating between the two Babses.
Absolutely. Oh, yeah.
One's got that monotone-ish voice, in other words, it's just all full of laughter and everything.
Yeah, it's hard to do sometimes. Because you're so used to playing this character a certain way, and then it's like, we need you to do the same character, but dead inside.
And then do the same character turned up to 25.
Yeah, and doing it...
And bounce back and forth between the two.
Because I'm guaranteed she probably had to do all of this in like one recording session.
Now, it's possible she recorded one set of lines first, then the other set of lines second, because, you know, editing.
Yeah.
But still.
Yeah, I would almost say they probably wanted to try to get her done in one session, just, you know, sometimes with these shows, they do them at breakneck speeds just to get them out.
Yeah. Now, when Babs asks Hampton what she's supposed to sound like, the humorous side of Babs launches into more over-the-top antics, tying Hampton up in his overalls and calling this the height of hog fashion. Breaking out of a window, Hampton states the obvious that Babs has lost her sense of humor. And cue Babs Prime, now dressed as a stereotypical librarian, playing solitaire and saying there's nothing in the world to laugh about.
On behalf of librarians everywhere, I don't like that. And I'm not a librarian, but I know librarians. I'd be like, dude, they have probably the wickedest sense of humor.
No librarians were harmed in the making of this podcast.
I just have to say it on behalf of John, okay? He works in a library, and John has an awesome sense of humor.
So Hampton vows to retrieve her sense of humor and grabs Calamity to assist. And on the way, the latter explains to the former that the worst that could happen is said sense of humor evaporates once the sun sets and leaves Babs a dull nerd. Not the funny kind of nerd, not the ones pop culture used to tell the corniest jokes of the 90s, but the stick in the mud she was just compared to.
Sorry, we're not talking Big Bang Theory. We're not talking Sheldon. I'm not sure what kind we're talking about.
I don't want to talk Sheldon either.
I hope Babs isn't Sheldon. That'd be crazy.
It'd be worse than Sheldon.
Yes.
So when Hampton states this all, Calamity congratulates his grasp of the obvious by proclaiming him a graduate of the school of, well, duh, complete with cap and gown, and a hearty handshake.
Oh, she's been nice.
Exactly. I mean, this is probably as sarcastic as Calamity Coyote actually gets sometimes.
It's just such a great bit of slapstick. Light slapstick, but still slapstick.
Well, I mean, for a character that doesn't speak, it's awesome.
Yeah. Passing laughing inmates at the Acme Acres jail, they decide they're on the right track and follow the bouncing sense of humor. Humor Babs floats into a hospital where Hampton and Calamity catch up to her, and the chase is on as Calamity tries to rig up a means to catch her. Humor Babs can't help but continue with the reality-warping mischief, writing a T in the word surgeon's lounge to make it a sturgeon's lounge.
Listen, I'm still trying to find the surgeon's lounge in my hospital. I have a residence room.
Yeah, I haven't found it either.
I know, we work in the same hospital, too.
Now, the device Calamity whips up is a pie, since they reason no sense of humor can resist a pie gag. So Hampton sets her up, and Calamity triggers the net. But their resolve to drag her back to Babs Prime leads to Humor Babs dragging them. Also, we want to point out the traditional quiet please sign is done in Elmer Fudd speak. It's asking people to be very, very quiet. Nice touch.
Yeah, that was a nice touch.
And they are hunting a rabbit at the time.
They are indeed.
Which is even a better touch.
So sending them through the cafeteria food, Babs chides Hampton for adding his own jokes. But Calamity remembers his Pratfalls 101 class and deploys another classic, the banana peel. Again, this is a sense of humor, so the classic banana peel gag will certainly work.
Indeed.
Well, Donkey Kong would be proud.
It lands Babs in a food cart, which the coyote lines up with bars to keep her fully restrained, and he and Hampton race to get the silly superego back to Babs Prime as the sun is starting to set.
Also remember, they're also in Luniversity, so Pratfalls 101 is a good class for them.
Mm-hmm. I think Sylvester teaches that.
Sounds about right for Sylvester.
They crash back into the lab where Babs is enjoying Wall Street News while eating mayo on white bread.
Ew.
That's just so devilish.
I know. It's like, ooh.
Who in their right mind ever wants to eat mayo on white?
Exactly. It's like, ooh. As a kid, we're all shuddering. As kids watching this, we probably all shuddered at home. Like, oh my God.
I shuddered earlier when I was watching it because I don't much care for mayo.
Me neither.
Yeah.
They crash again to the counter, which sends the sense of humor tumbling back into Babs just in time. She's grateful to the duo as she swerves off further experiments, and Hampton says their efforts were nothing.
Nothing? I am with Calamity on this one.
Yeah, his irate sign of nothing and the fainting spell he endures says it all. As Buster, as Rod Serling, sums up the Acme Acre Zone theme to the episode with a standard be yourself moral. While Barky Marky, who's an analog to Mark Anthony, comes in for Buster's toupee, which is furball.
I thought that was clever. I actually thought that was really clever having furball be his toupee.
I agree.
But you know what? Calamity successfully caught something for once. Woohoo!
Good job, Calamity.
See, he can catch things occasionally.
As long as he's not catching it for himself.
Mm-hmm. Now, I should mention that when responding to the series in development, the ever outspoken Chuck Jones was not especially enthused about the team's characters based on the Looney Tunes cast members he created, namely Calamity, Beeper, and Barky Marky.
Which I'm going to say, I'm not a big fan of Barky Marky. I'm sorry, I'm not.
He's a flat character, admittedly. It's cute, but there's better dog characters in the show.
Yep.
But Chuck went to call these three redacted redheaded stepchildren. I tried to look this up, but the source interview provided with Tom Ruger doesn't go that far. Now, Chuck, if you can hear this from beyond the grave, I love you. Your work is an inspiration to me. Always will be. But I think you missed the mark with Calamity. This little fellow is distinct from Wile E in that he's so much more sympathetic. While Wile E looks like, well, a hungry, vicious predator, Calamity's harmless looking.
Calamity's just trying to make things, whereas Wile E was just out trying to catch the Roadrunner most of the time.
Yeah.
And this isn't to say that Wile E isn't sympathetic. After all, one of the rules of the Roadrunner cartoons is the audience sympathies should remain with the coyote.
Yeah, you feel bad for him after a while, where you're like, aw, dude, you just keep trying.
But as a mostly silent, intelligent, relatable character with both virtues and faults, Calamity is generally a positive and fun, neurodivergent-coded character, whether that's the team's intention or not. And as someone who is himself on the autism spectrum, that means something to me.
Yeah.
So I hope I get the chance to meet Tom Ruger and tell him that and tell him thank you.
Have you ever written anything to Tom Ruger to tell him that?
I haven't, because this is kind of a realization I made as I was writing the script.
I think you should, because I think that'd be awesome for him to hear. I didn't do any research into it because it was something I thought about the other day, and I was just like, and then of course I got sick, and then reality decided to beat me upside the head when my mom was like, hey, we have all this stuff I need to do, and I need you to go do it. that's what happens when you live with your parents. I wonder how many of the episodes Tom Jones actually watched, or if he just was like, no, I'm not a fan of it, bye. Like, because some people, when they get older, they do that, where they just don't look into something. Just like, no, I have no interest of watching it. I really don't care to. Because I bet you if he watched some of these episodes, he may have actually had a different opinion.
Maybe. So
I wonder if, because that's part of it, is like, did he watch any of these, or did he just see clips and was like, I have no interest? Because it could be a possibility that that's part of the reason why he was so dismissive of them, too.
Maybe.
Yeah, but I agree with you.
All we've got is that one instance to go off of.
Exactly, but I agree with you. Calamity is awesome the way he is. I mean, you just love Calamity for Calamity being Calamity. Like, that's one of my favorite things about Calamity's cartoons is just, like, I find him to be a very fun character to watch because he's just fun. He's a fun little guy.
So when we return, though, we look at the lady whose fandom eclipses Calamity, probably eclipses Furballs, and eclipses all but arguably Buster and Babs themselves.
Wee-wee. Hi, everyone. This is Chrissy. On our next podcast episode, he robbed from the rich and he gave to the poor and barely salvaged what started as a movie about Reynard Fox. Disney's Robin Hood had a tumultuous production history that led them to using animation techniques that other companies were raked over the coals for. So join us as we aim for the bullseye in our very first featured film review in 2 weeks. See you then.
Friends, there has been much ado about Pepe Le Pew of late.
Even in our own podcast.
Whether his cartoons are appropriate for modern sensibilities, what could be done to his character to adjust for said sensibilities, and on and on. And yet, if his only legacy is inspiring Fifi La Fume, that may well be enough to keep him relevant to an entire generation of cartoon fans. Fifi is the ensemble dark horse of the series by far, with such an outspoken fandom that a counter-fandom has even emerged, believing the fanaticism for this femme fantastique overshadows much of what the show also did. Heck, another member of Pemmy's Discord, Darkfire Taimatsu, offered to filibuster, or Fifi Buster, which sounds like he's pairing Fifi with Buster. But he just wanted to talk about the character and threatened to do so for the entire run of this episode. We're already running quite a while.
Well, there was that one brief bit where she did disguise as Buster.
That was great.
Well, true or not, Fifi has joined the ranks of anthropomorphic characters who led to awakenings of certain tastes in certain fans. But it also helps that Fifi, in addition to being a pursuer, is rather unlike her inspiration in that she doesn't mind being romantically pursued, meaning she gives as good as she gets.
Unless it is a certain person.
Yes. It also just happens that on the day we're recording this, the previous day was National Skunk Day. Yes, aww. This is apparently a thing.
Listen, anything is a national holiday, okay? I've come to that conclusion.
Yeah.
There is a National Clean Your Room Day.
Well, there's one I don't observe.
There's one none of us observes. Apparently it comes before Mother's Day.
Oh, that's appropriate then.
I know, exactly. That's appropriately timed.
That's scary.
Anyhow, this next short not only lets us discuss her, but also lets us talk about Elmira. And it closes the circle we discussed in the Harley Quinn episode we did last year. It's Out of Odor, written by Arlene Sorkin and Beth Milstein, and directed by Art Leonardi.
Also, the Harley Quinn episode is when I debuted.
Officially.
Officially. As a third co-host. Officially, unofficially.
And you see, that's why we made you official, because we couldn't remember if you were unofficially official or officially unofficial.
So we just dropped one of them, just like you're official.
Yeah. Now, the main episode this short hails from is Viewer Mail Day, and it's prefaced in the linking material by Babs reading a letter about a sick kid wishing for a visit from Fifi. The kid is Elmira, who says she'll do anything to get a cute kitty.
Mm-hmm.
She's not a kitty. She's a skunk.
I know.
Now, Elmira, of course, is performed by Cree Summer. Her first appearance in the podcast, in fact. Cree is a multidisciplinary actress whose voice acting start was as Penny in Deke's most lasting original property, Inspector Gadget. And she'd take on a wide variety of other roles in animation. But as far as this show goes, she'd also perform as Mary Melody. Furthermore, she would take variations of this Elmira voice and parlay it into a number of other characters in shows ranging wildly in tones, from Rugrats, Susie Carmichael, to Kids Next Door, Number 5, to Drawn Together, Foxy Love.
Yep.
She got a lot of mileage out of this voice, and good for her.
You just have to add a different tone to it, and you have a whole different voice.
I loved her as Number 5.
Yeah, she was really good at number 5 for Kid Next Door.
Mm-hmm. We open at Fifi's home, which is a broken-down car in the city dump. Now, Acme Acres Child Protective Services, between her and Furball, get your asses in gear.
Yeah, let's move it, people.
But Fifi narrates to us strange occurrences, beginning with a dish of cream just outside her car door. Fifi's actress is Kath Soucie, another long-tenured actress whose other roles include Linka on Captain Planet, Phil and Lil on Rugrats, and several iterations of Looney Tunes' comparative newcomer, Lola Bunny. In other words, if it's a female cartoon character from the late 80s through the early 90s to the mid-90s, and you had a crush on her, it might have been her.
She's two of my favorite characters, that's for sure.
So the oddities continue with flea collars in Fifi's locker, and her desk being turned into a sandbox. Normally, given the eventual context, this would lead to a number of gross thoughts, but knowing who the perpetrator is, Elmira almost certainly must literally think a cat sandbox is a plaything for use with beach toys, just like we see in the gag.
You know, no, I got nothing. Okay, forget CPS. Someone needs to call, you know, the psych ward.
Fifi realizes someone must think she's a cat, and as she scans the class, while little Beeper tosses a paper airplane to Calamity, jerk.
I feel like Beeper and Calamity just have that kind of fun rivalry between the two of them at this point.
When Fifi realizes who it is, the exasperated Sacre Bleu and the look on her face is priceless.
I really wanted Fifi. Fifi just needs to just beat her up. I've never caused violence often in school, but man, this is just one of those times that, honey, telling her ain't gonna get very far. Elmira's stupid.
Hi, cute stinky kitty. All these wild and intrusive presents are a lure to get Fifi to be her pet. And Fifi protests she's not a kitten, just as the bell rings. And Elmer Fudd, performed by Jeff Bergman here, is about to start class. Apparently, he's teaching either literature or drama, since the subject is the play Cat on a Hot Tin Roof. He asks Fifi to read the part of Maggie the Cat, which is more proof for Elmira.
I refer back to my original statement about Elmira's intelligence.
Yeah.
I knew you were a kitty. No, dummy, it's a part.
Aha! I knew you were pretty kitty, Winnie! I may be witty. I most certainly am pretty, but I am not, repeat, I'm not a kitty.
Now this continues in a basketball game against Perfecto Prep. Oh, we have to explain Perfecto Prep, don't we? Well, simply put, picture the core Disney characters, you know, Mickey and friends, as rotten to the core, spoiled rich bullies. And you basically have it.
In other words, they're making fun of Disney.
Something this team would do a lot.
Yeah. Which is kind of fun.
Well, after that, being back when you do the regular Perfecto Prep.
I love the fact in Perfecto Prep they actually have the Mickey ripoff dating the Donald ripoff.
I think that might have just been for an episode because they're usually together. Rubella and Roderick are usually together.
That's true. I think it was for an episode.
They could be a threesome.
Sure, that's they true. Are rich and well brat, so it's very possible.
You know, thruples can be a thing.
Sylvester, again, Jeff Bergman, though Joe Alasky would do the Sylvester voice for some episodes too. He's calling the girls' championship game as Babs passes the ball to Fifi. And Elmira starts blocking her shot just to get a huggy-wuggy.
Apparently, Myra did not pay attention to this is a team sport, not a this is your time to try to cop a feel.
Fifi so vociferously insists she's a skunk. The scent clouds spell it out. And the mental malfunction this causes in Elmira's brain launches her like a rocket for the winning shot. As the team excitedly carries Fifi, with Hampton there too. I imagine he's a student assistant for the girls' team.
Well, also, sometimes in the episode, they have Hampton and Fifi together as a couple too.
Yeah, but, you know, he's in uniform, so I imagine an assistant coach or something like that.
Probably.
But Elmira is the one holding her aloft, and Fifi races away. So we turn to the library with the sign, "Be quiet or be history." Another great
signs in history.
Elmira is looking for her next tactic, specifically to erase the stink. It seems like it's finally gotten through to her head.
Yeah, that she's a skunk.
But Fifi's still pretty enough for her.
I think at this point, it's not so much that she's pretty, it's just Elmira just is tenacious and doesn't like being told no.
Well, could be a little bit of column A, a little bit of column B.
And column C is just Elmira's stupid.
Yeah. But she finds the correct method, tomato juice, and hatches her plan for that night. Cherry tomatoes, disguised in a Valentine's chocolate box, and Elmira herself disguised as the idol of Fifi's eye, Pepe Le Pew.
Always love that she disguises as Pepe.
That was really a good throwback.
Disguises almost always work in Looney Tunes-style shorts.
Oh,
so
yeah.
Despite Elmira not being able to disguise her voice, Fifi falls for it. And gives Pepe Le Duff a bone-crushing hug as she admits her crush on the senior skunk. So Elmira presents the candies, then plants them in Fifi's face, which is enough for Fifi to realize the ruse, and the chase is on all through the night and into the morning. Fifi tries to lose Elmira in the Acme Acres Rose Parade as it passes by, commandeering a pageant winner's convertible car by scaring her, the driver, and the entire crowd off with her mere presence. Skunk in a cartoon, you know.
Hey, that's usually what happens. I mean, we've seen it with Pepe so many times in his.
Elmira follows in one of the parade floats, and jokes to the audience she doesn't even have a learner's permit. I'm not even sure she passed kindergarten.
Oh, she didn't. I'm pretty sure her parents paid for her to make it to Luniversity. We hear in a later episode that her parents have money. That's why Montana Max is forced to go out with her.
So the chase leads to a car wash, which washes off the tomato juice from Fifi and knocks the roses on Elmira's float into her car. She's allergic to roses, it turns out. And Fifi is allergic to Elmira. So she opens fire with her tail, complete with buff Rambo body and headband. Gender is fluid.
This is true.
But when she tuckers herself out, the allergens from the roses killed Elmira's sense of smell, which means she can take Fifi home.
This ending stinks.
Elmira drags Fifi home in her tender, gentle, loving fashion. 1 out of 3, anyway.
Yeah. So, interestingly enough, because there's only one factual flaw with this episode, is actually tomato juice does not make skunk odor go away.
Really?
No.
Oh.
It's not strong enough. It can mask the smell for a short period of time, but it is not strong enough to actually chemically neutralize skunk odor.
Huh.
Did not know that.
You actually have to take your dog either to a vet or a groomer, and there's actual shampoo chemicals that will actually do that. It's an old wives' tale.
Okay.
Yeah, it will mask it long enough for you to get the dog to the groomers. But tomato juice itself, not strong enough.
Well, there's my learn something new for the day.
I'm so glad I am so glad when I can contribute.
Now, we would be remiss if we didn't talk about how apparently somebody at Warner or Amblin at the time loved Elmira to a degree that became unhealthy.
Oh, yeah, they did. I don't know why.
The show's 78th episode, Take Elmira, Please, was a thinly disguised pilot for an Elmira-centric spinoff, and featured her doing a spot with Mr. Scullyhead, basically her imagining the adventures of the little skull on her bow, that one presumes would have been a reoccurring segment in such a spinoff. Mr. Scullyhead actually wound up getting a role in Animaniacs for their reoccurring Good Idea, Bad Idea segments. In fact, here's our own Good Idea, Bad Idea. Chrissy?
Good idea, giving breakout characters Pinky and the Brain their own spinoff series. Bad idea, completely retooling that spinoff series to include Elmira in it. The executive mandating meddling was so unpopular that the resulting season of the show was canceled before the run of episodes could be finished.
That doesn't happen very often.
I wonder why.
When you reduce Pinky, one of the greatest comic relief characters ever devised, to a straight man, you've done something wrong.
The reason Pinky and the Brain works so well is you have a straight man and a funny man. Brain is a great straight man. But when you have two absolutely insane characters and that you make Pinky look sane, Pinky looks sane. You got a problem. I'm done.
Yeah, so am I. But finally, Chrissy suggested we look at the music videos from the episode Tiny Toons Music Television. Specifically the first two, since the creative team got permission from cult favorite indie band They Might Be Giants.
I love They Might Be Giants. That's why I recommended it, because this was my introduction to They Might Be Giants.
It was to use their songs Istanbul and Particle Man. And these two music videos acted as a gateway to a new breed of TMBG fans like Chrissy. So, mission accomplished there, eh?
This actually helped their record, the album that these were from, Flood, become such a big hit, because these are two songs off of that album. The other song off of that album that also became a big hit was Birdhouse in Your Soul. Mm. Build a little birdhouse in your soul, not to put too fine a point on it. Say I'm the only bee in your bonnet. Build a little birdhouse in your soul. There's so many good songs on that album. They actually just did a tour. I think it was like the 25th anniversary of that album or something. Okay. 30th, 35th? I'm not sure. I wanted to go see them in concert, but I didn't have the money to go see them, and they didn't really come anywhere close to here, so I was very bummed. But these two music videos were the first time I've heard of They Might Be Giants, and for the longest time, I thought they were the official music videos for They Might Be Giants. They weren't.
Yeah, I disabused myself of that notion last night, too.
Yeah, they really weren't.
The Istanbul music video was surreal.
Istanbul music video, you watch it and you're just like, dudes, I'm going to take the Tiny Toons as the official music video, because I don't know who you paid to make that other one. You paid too much.
Very much so.
Yeah. And then James sent me something that you found out, is that actually Istanbul is a cover.
Mm-hmm. The original version was done by the Four Lads.
Who, when I was playing it in the car earlier today, because me and my mom went to the store and I actually ended up playing it, and my mom was like, oh, I know that band. That's the Four Lads. Like, I didn't even tell her what it was. I was like, oh, James sent me a link. I'm going to play it real quick. So I played it. And she's like, oh, that's the Four Lads. And I'm like, yeah. And she's like, oh, I used to have a crush on them. I go, oh, really? Which one? All four of them. My mother was a player. Things I learned about my mom. Also, she apparently grew up in the same neighborhood as the Hillside Strangler.
Anyway.
I was named after one of my mom's crushes at the time, so I can relate.
Well, my mom didn't have a crush on him. She thought he was creepy, but she dropped that bombshell on me the other day, too. And I was just like, wait, what? Mom? Way to bury the lead as a true crime fan.
Now, truthfully, there's not a ton to these two music videos plot-wise, since they're, well, music videos. They're short. Shorter than a short subject.
But fun.
But they're interesting nonetheless.
Oh, yeah.
Exactly.
Now, Istanbul, not Constantinople, is the first one, and it takes place there with Plucky and Hampton charged with retrieving a stolen jade duck statue. with the promise of a princess's hand in marriage if they do it. Montana Max is the thief's ringleader, and it turns out the princess is Elmira. Statue shatters, and Plucky has to stand in for it from then on.
Another thing that's interesting about this is it's one of the few times Plucky doesn't go nuts over money.
That's true.
Yeah, that is interesting.
Yeah, because he's not doing it for the money. He was doing it for the what looked to be at first a very attractive woman.
I'll tell you honestly and truthfully, that would have gotten my attention.
And also, the best clip of it is when they're doing the chase scene before they enter Istanbul, is when the camel stops and they go, guess they just wanted that way, and then continues chasing.
People just liked it better that way.
Yeah, and then they just continue into town, and I'm just like, that's great. It was very well-timed to the music. It's one of my, like I said, it's one of my favorites.
Oh, yeah, especially at the beginning when they're breaking the glass, it's the cymbal crashes each time.
Yeah.
Now the second one, Particle Man, is in a wrestling setting, as Plucky, as Particle Man, is obliterated by one massive lug that the song also describes after another. Now, the third wrestler in this procession of pain, Person Man, might be the twin brother of the Crusher from the 1951 Looney Tunes short Bunny Hugged. Because it's the same design, basically, just a different beard color.
That's true.
He could have just dyed it. We don't know.
It could be, yeah, it's true. 1951. Yeah, he could have had a son that was about that age.
Yeah. The saxophone solo in this one is portrayed as an accordion played by Dizzy Devil, who is the purple analog to the Tasmanian Devil and another character we may have to squeeze into part two. Also, that's one odd-sounding sax.
Yeah, but they had to find a way of putting Dizzy in there, and could you really see Dizzy Devil playing a saxophone?
His arms are a little stubby for that.
Yeah, I could, but somehow the accordion was more fun.
Well, being a Weird Al fan, I have to say the accordion's always more fun.
That's true.
Yeah. They do a lot with one of those squeeze boxes.
I was very surprised they didn't get Weird Al's permission to do any of his songs, but then again, a lot of his songs are parodies to begin with, so that might be a rights issue.
Yeah.
Waffle King might have worked.
It could have. Yeah, you're right. Waffle King probably could have worked. Oh, introducing Weird Al to a whole new set of young fans. Aw.
But yeah, there's a good reason Chrissy picked these, because they're freaking brilliant. In fact, the whole Tiny Toons Music Television episode is wonderful. And if you're going to start anywhere, start with that one.
Oh my god, it's such a... They do Respect with Babs.
And Montana Max does Money, the old Motown hit. The first Motown hit.
It's a great episode. If you guys want to get into Tiny Toons, just get a feel for the timing of Tiny Toons. This is one of the best episodes to start with. It was my favorite when it came on.
But one last thing about these videos. They Might Be Giants member John Flansbush wasn't too thrilled about his voice coming out of Hampton J. Pig, being quoted as saying, "There's something about being animated as a pig that keeps you coming back for less." Ouch.
Yeah, he caught some flack for that, though. He kind of did. Because people were like, dude, they got you new fans. Stop bitching.
Yeah. So yeah, Tiny Toons was a smash hit in syndication, including several Fox affiliates, like ours here in Rochester.
Mm-hmm. Oh my god, yes.
Which made moving the show from syndication to Fox a no-brainer. Part of a massive partnership between Fox and Warner that also included Tasmania, Batman the Animated Series, the remainder of the run of the Beetlejuice cartoon, and eventually Animaniacs.
That was the power lineup that got you to stay on Fox to watch all of this stuff.
Not to mention The Tick, Bobby's World, and X-Men.
Yeah. And then the Spider-Man cartoon would come on, would eventually join that. And all. I mean, Fox had the best lineup of afternoon cartoons.
And when Fox picked up Tiny Toons, this is something I forgot in the script, they also retooled the Plucky Duck-centric episodes and created one more new one to go along with it to be Saturday morning's The Plucky Duck Show.
Oh yeah, that's right. They did do that.
In addition to those new episodes, this also included some specials made for the Fox Network for Halloween and spring break / Easter.
Yeah, that's right.
Now this partnership dissolved once Warner created their own competing network, the WB. and reruns of Tiny Toons would appear there for a few years. These episodes would then jump to Cartoon Network, then Nickelodeon, then finally The Hub, formerly Discovery Kids. All episodes are readily available for sale on various platforms and in various formats. Though not all of them. There's, for instance, on YouTube and iTunes, there's only 64 of the 78 episode run.
Yeah.
Now, we're not going to talk... Well, before we go into that, I just want to mention how obsessed my sister and I were with this series. We were so bad with it that one day we had to do a family function, and we're like, but we're going to miss Tiny Toons! But we're going to miss Tiny Toons! But we're going to miss Tiny Toons! And Mom and Dad had to promise to record it for us.
I can't help but think of the old Gallagher segment. Flipper's on every channel! The president's on every channel. We're going to miss Flipper.
I remember when I first heard of Tiny Toons, because we would spend the summers up in Canada, because we actually used to have an old log cabin in the deepest, darkest parts of Canada. The best way I could tell you where you could probably find the area it was in was go literally north of Toronto for 3 hours. Just drive 3 hours straight north and you'll eventually hit the area we were. We picked up a Canadian magazine, and on the back page was an advertisement for Tiny Toons.
That same ad ran in America, too, in the Looney Tunes magazine. That's where I saw it.
This was a year before it actually premiered.
Yep.
Yep. And I remember seeing it. I'm like, oh, my God, I want to watch this show. I need to watch this show. I have to watch this show because it was Looney Tunes. And I was a huge Looney Tunes fan growing up. And my cousin was like, it's probably never going to show in America because this is a Canadian magazine. It's probably a Canadian thing. Because there was a lot of shows they were advertising in Canada that we didn't see in our area of the United States.
The Raccoons, for instance, unless you had the Disney Channel.
Which we did because my dad.
I knew of it growing up, but I don't think I ever really saw anything of it.
The only time you would ever, if you didn't have the Disney Channel, the only time you actually saw the Raccoons is when Disney did like that free week. Like, the only time some kids saw Fraggle Rock was when HBO did the free week of HBO, where suddenly Channel 14, you could watch it, and you could watch Fraggle Rock. Mm-hmm. Like, my best friend never watched Fraggle Rock because they didn't have HBO unless HBO was free that week, and then he would, like, binge Fraggle Rock for that week.
I remember watching Fraggle Rock. I know we had HBO sometimes, not all the time, but sometimes we had HBO, and I'd watch Fraggle Rock growing up, but I don't ever remember seeing Raccoons. I'll ask my brother about that. He might remember.
Yeah, but like, I remember the one time my dad got rid of HBO. We actually used to listen to HBO, not watch it, but you could still go to the Channel 14 and hear it. So we would go to it to hear it and just listen to it like it was the radio.
Now, back on our subject, we're not going to talk about some of the behind-the-scenes stuff as regard to voice actors coming, going, or otherwise having difficulty with their roles. Since the majority of those stories revolve around performers who were not heavily featured in the shorts we watched. So rest assured, once again, when we do get to more Plucky, Buster, and Max-centric material, we will take a look at those behind-the-scenes tales. And while I could also prattle on about merchandise, video games, and all the usual tie-in shenanigans that followed in the show's wake, I want to actually bring up things that almost happened but didn't. First up, Tiny Toons at Universal Studios Florida.
That would have been fucking awesome.
That does sound awesome.
The early plans for the park that would become Islands of Adventure was Universal's Cartoon World, intended to focus on animated and illustrated properties. And the Tiny Toons were one of several character families Universal was considering to make use of in an effort to more directly compete with Disney and attract the younger audience the mouse is best known to cater to. Specifically, the Tiny Toons would have been a possible replacement property if negotiations with Audrey Geisel, the widow of Dr. Seuss, couldn't bring that family of characters to this planned park. The other possible replacement being the Hanna-Barbera crew that Universal did have full park rights to at that time. Now, if Dr. Seuss did come home to roost and not stay on the loose, then the Tiny Toons would have been part of a Looney Tunes-centric land for the same park. Now, Audrey Geisel did eventually give Universal her blessing, and all negotiations with Warner in general for their cartoon and comic properties never came to fruition, meaning this potential theme park run for the Acme Lou crew was over before it could even begin.
Which is a shame, because it would have been so popular, I think, because it was such an interesting show to watch as a kid.
And it would definitely have given Mickey a run for his money, because it was such a hit.
And similarly, the Tiny Toons would never jump to Six Flags like their successors, the Animaniacs, briefly would.
I didn't know about that.
Yeah, the Animaniacs spent a couple summers at Six Flags.
Yeah, they were up, I mean, the Six Flags up by us, up here in Western New York, had them for a couple summers, too. They weren't as pop, I mean, they were good, but, I mean, I think Tiny Toons would have been a bigger hit.
Oh, yeah. I think it could still be a good hit if they had bring them to the park, but not they ever will.
Now, one other unfulfilled project that came so close to fruition that we could practically taste it was Tiny Toons Defenders of the Universe, a game from Treasure, one of the most revered development groups in hardcore gaming circles, that was slated for the PS2 and GameCube. They went to great lengths to reunite the cast, even bringing back Charles Adler to perform as Buster after his falling out with the team of the show. That's that one of those behind-the-scenes things I alluded to a moment ago. And casting Billy West as Hampton to replace the late Don Messick. Kurt Collada, whose Hardcore Gaming 101 books are some of the best out there for people looking for deep dives into gaming franchises, and Kurt himself is a big Treasure fan, he speculated that based on the screenshots that were shown, the game would be a thematic follow-up to a 1999 game they made called Rakugaki Showtime that was only released in Japan. Now, this Tiny Toons game was never formally canceled, and an essentially completed ROM leaked in 2009. In the end, supposedly after a while, someone at Warner lost interest or decided the platforms in question weren't relevant anymore. The world may never know.
Or, given their history, tax write-off.
Ugh.
Release Wily versus Acme.
So, this would be the final project for these characters until just very recently, with the release of Tiny Toons Looniversity on Max, which would shortly join the Cartoon Network schedule after that. Now, there's been a lot of discussion about the changes made to these characters and how it overall compares to the original show, and that's a discussion I can't join in good faith, having not yet watched the series beyond a couple short clips and listening to a That's Not Quite All Folks podcast on the subject.
Hi, Mark. Hi, Jordan.
So, much the same as the tales we've left untold of these young toons in training, consider this a to-be-continued, at least for me, along with the many, many, many other loose ends we still have to return to. To think Chrissy and I picked this podcast to tie up one loose end, the Arlene Sorkin connection, and we wound up with like four more now.
Oh, honey, this is the world of cartoons. You're never going to fully tie up a loose end. It's kind of like a puzzle. It's a web.
It's a toon thing. You can't ever tie us up and get rid of us that easily.
Exactly. We're just going to keep going until someone finally cancels our butt. Which will be never. I won't allow it to happen.
I don't know. My butt's a pretty big target.
Once again, I will never allow it to happen.
Especially with this raccoon tail.
Exactly. Raccoons are sneaky.
I'm so sneaky. I mean, I'm known for my disguising.
There we go. We have an elite crew.
Not to mention Bugs is my father. I mean, come on.
Any final thoughts?
Tiny Toons was definitely awesome. And my recommendation to the audience, if you get a chance to go out and watch classic Tiny Toon Adventures, go for it. If you get a chance to play any of the classic Tiny Toons video games, play it any way you can. Which is my way of saying play it any way you can. It's very hard to find some of the games right now in the normal way. So play it any way you can, because I played them on my little recal box, and it's always fun to go down there. When I used to go to my grandma's house and she used to watch me, I used to go up to Wegmans to rent the first Tiny Toons game all the time. And I used to take my Nintendo, my NES with me to her house. And anyone who's ever tried to set up a Nintendo, the old Nintendo, knows how much of a pain that is.
Because
I wanted to beat the game. So I used to lug that between our house and her house and get that set up so I could constantly play the game. And there were no saves.
That's Konami for you.
Yeah, we're not going to talk about Konami.
No, we leave that to Pim.
Don't get me and Pim started.
Mio, anything you want to add?
Yes.
I really enjoyed Fifi's episode. I enjoyed her, and I enjoyed the Peppy Le Pew costume, obviously. If you know me, you know that I love costumes.
But oh, yes.
I just really enjoyed that aspect, you know, the whole disguising and everything and fooling them real easily that way.
Good. I'm glad.
They brought back a lot of what made Looney Tunes fun.
Well, it's time to restock the breakfast cereal, so say goodnight, Chrissy.
Goodnight, Chrissy.
Au revoir, my petite potato to couch.
This is a Pam and Jens and Chrissy sort of kind of hopefully funny cartoon podcast.
The preceding podcast is a co-production of Artificial Orange Studios and Mighty Monkey Productions. The theme song is written, composed, and performed by Teletoon. For questions and comments, send me an email at james@fc3roc.org.